Having the sun as your neighbor is hard. Searing hot temperatures, deadly radiation, and the onslaught of meteor collisions don't exactly make it the most welcoming part of the solar system. As you can imagine, these challenges make Mercury a particularly tricky place to get to. For this reason, even though it's much closer to us than Jupiter or Saturn, Mercury remains relatively unexplored. Still, scientists managed to send two different missions out to study Mercury. Mariner 10 flew by in the 1970s, followed by NASA's Messenger in 2015, which was the first probe to ever successfully orbit the planet. And now, as I speak, a third Mercury mission is hurtling through the constellation of Pisces, over 177 million kilometers away from Earth. BepiColombo, a labor of love between the European Space Agency and the Japanese Aerospace Exploration Agency, is set to arrive on December 5th, 2025. It will carry out a comprehensive study of the planet's magnetic field, surface, and internal structure. But, as they say, the journey is the destination, and BepiColombo's journey is a long one. I'm Alex McColgan, and you're watching Astrum. Join me today as we reveal what BepiColombo has revealed of Mercury so far, why it's traveling farther than the distance of Pluto to get there, and what we're hoping to learn about the closest planet to the Sun. On October 20th, 2018, BepiColombo took off from the French Guiana Space Center, beginning its 7-year journey to Mercury. Its trajectory would take it around the Sun 18 times, including 9 planet flybys. The first was an extremely close flyby of Earth on April 10th, 2020. BepiColombo came within just 12,700 kilometers of our planet's surface, about the distance from Copenhagen to Santiago, Chile. Its journey will then take it on 2 flybys of Venus and 6 of Mercury, the last 3 of which are due to happen in September, December, and January of next year. In total, the mighty spacecraft will cover a distance of 8.5 billion kilometers. Taking such a long route was the only way BepiColombo could slow down enough before approaching Mercury's orbit. But why is slowing down so important? Well, if the spacecraft arrived with too much speed, it would swing right past the planet and get sucked into the Sun's powerful gravitational field instead. BepiColombo was designed to complement and deepen the findings of its predecessor, the Messenger probe. While BepiColombo carries many of the same instruments as Messenger did, it is equipped with higher caliber tools able to obtain larger ranges of data. Additionally, Messenger's orbit of Mercury was rather one-sided. Its periapsis was over the South Pole, meaning we have great detail and mapping of the Northern Hemisphere and almost non-existent data on the Southern Hemisphere. BepiColombo plans to rectify this by examining Mercury from an orbital angle more in line with the planet's equator. BepiColombo is a very unique spacecraft. It's made up of 3 component parts, 2 probes and a propulsion module, which were launched and traveled together in a united configuration known as the Mercury Cruise System. Run by ESA, the Mercury Planetary Orbiter, or MPO, will study the planet's surface and interior, while JAXA's Mercury Magnetosphere Orbiter, affectionately known as MIO, will study the planet's suspiciously low magnetic field that has baffled scientists for decades. The name of MIO was actually chosen by the Japanese general public. It means a waterway, and according to JAXA, it symbolizes the scientific milestones reached so far, and wishes for safe travels to come. MIO and the MPO sit either side of an interplanetary propulsion unit called the Messenger Transfer Module. Stacking the different parts of the craft together like this means most, but not all, of the scientific instruments on board will be inoperative until BepiColombo settles into its orbit around Mercury. At that point, the MPO and MIO will be jettisoned from the spacecraft and go their separate ways to study Mercury from different vantage points. But don't worry, there's still enough data being sent back to keep us entertained. Why don't we take a look back at how far this mission has come, what it's already taught us, and explore some of the amazing things it's seen along the way. BepiColombo's first encounter with Mercury came in October 2021. Passing just 200 kilometers above the planet's surface, it sent back some stunning images. As it drifted past, BepiColombo snapped Mercury's northern hemisphere. To the average person, it might look like our rocky, inert moon, but the trained eye sees the Calvino crater, which could hold the key to deciphering Mercury's crust composition. The Lermontov crater hosts traces of volcanic activity, and mysterious pockets where an unidentified compound in the planet's crust is being lost to space, and scientists have no idea how or why. These images remind us just how enigmatic Mercury is, and how much we have left to learn about it. Another camera mounted on the spacecraft caught Mercury from another perspective, one that left the planet's volcanic history on full display. Previously lava flooded, and over 250 kilometers wide, the Hayden crater comes into view, along with the Pampu Facula, one of Mercury's many bright spots, probably formed by volcanic eruptions from billions of years ago. Even though MESSENGER had already shown us Mercury's volcanic past, it's still pretty amazing that this activity left a mark visible after such an inconceivable amount of time. And BepiColombo didn't just show us how the flyby looked, it captured how the flyby felt. You know how your phone has an accelerometer in it that helps it know when and how its orientation changes? Scientists mounted a similar accelerometer on BepiColombo's MPO. It measured the movements and vibrations of the spacecraft as it flew past Mercury, creating a sort of sound map of the flyby. Scientists then plotted that data to frequencies us humans can actually hear, so you can actually hear the flyby. I'll play it for you now. Pay attention to the two distinct sounds towards the beginning. They represent the changes in solar radiation pressure when the spacecraft enters and then exits Mercury's shadow. The big clunk towards the end is the sound of the Phoebus instrument assuming its parking position. Here's the clip. Pretty cool, right? I've got another one, and it's even better. BepiColombo captured magnetic field data during its flyby that was also later deciphered and sonified by scientists on the ground. This one is a little more abstract than the other, but we'll give it a go. You're going to hear two synthesizers at the same time. The first synthesizer changes pitch with the changing magnitude of the background magnetic field. A lower pitch means more intensity in the magnetic field. The second synthesizer changes pitch with the variations of the magnetic field magnitude. A more turbulent magnetic field is represented by a faster change in pitch. The dotted vertical line shows where the closest approach was. After the closest approach, you'll hear something that sounds like a DJ scratching a disc. Lots of fast changes in pitch. That, right there, marks when the spacecraft crosses the magnetosheath, where the magnetic field is highly turbulent. Let's have a listen. On June 23rd, 2022, just over halfway in its planned journey, BepiColombo crossed paths with Mercury once again. This time, the spacecraft turned its gaze towards Mercury's largest impact crater, Calaris Basin. At a whopping 1,550 kilometers wide, it's actually one of the widest known craters in the solar system. Calaris Basin was likely created by the collision of a comet, asteroid, or other celestial object some 3.9 billion years ago. The highly reflective lava craters on its floor make it easy to see as the bright semicircular area of Mercury's disk below the magnetometer boom. The second flyby gave us beautiful images of Mercury's craters like we'd never seen before. Like this one of Hieni, a crater embedded in smooth volcanic plains, potentially near an ancient volcano which BepiColombo plans to examine when it finally settles into orbit. Almost exactly a year later, on June 19th, 2023, BepiColombo reapproached Mercury from a height of just 263 kilometers. The flyby images captured the 600-kilometer-long Beagle Rupees, one of the many lobate scarps on Mercury that was first imaged by MESSENGER in 2008. Other than our moon, Mercury is the only planetary body in our solar system known to exhibit this tectonic signature. When the interior of the planetary body cools, it leads to a global contraction and surface expression of a thrust fault, aka a lobate scarp. Beagle Rupees has an especially pronounced curvature, more so than other scarps on Mercury, offering geologists a rare insight into the planet's tectonic history. As a result of the third BepiColombo flyby, a large 218-kilometer-wide peak ring impact crater received the name Manley after 20th century visual artist Edna Manley. The original basin floor was flooded by lava, giving the crater its visibly smooth interior texture. BepiColombo will explore Manley crater further from orbit, seeking to measure its carbon composition and detect other minerals that may be present in order to learn more about Mercury's geological history. Gliding past Mercury on its most recent flyby, BepiColombo snapped a series of farewell Mercury images. At 236 kilometers from the surface, BepiColombo appears to hug the planet goodbye. Scientists back home on Earth will have to wait another 16 months for the next set of images. Now, these flybys are more than an indulgence for our senses. They also revealed important nuances of the planet's particle environment and magnetic boundaries. One of the instruments aboard the MPO probe is Phoebus, probing of Hermian exosphere by ultraviolet spectroscopy. Phoebus uses UV emission from Mercury's exosphere, the planet's outermost and only atmospheric layer, to determine its composition, structure, and interactions with the surface. It does this by detecting specific types of light emissions in the ultraviolet spectrum, ranging from 55 to 350 nanometers. By capturing these light emissions across the whole spectrum, it helps us figure out what the exosphere is made of and how its particles are spread out. As BepiColombo emerged from Mercury's shadow, Phoebus detected the presence of hydrogen and calcium, confirming earlier findings from MESSENGER that established the presence of calcium in the planet's exosphere, particularly around the equator and on its night side. Interestingly, this is the opposite of the distribution observed for sodium and potassium, which more readily concentrate around the poles. Once in orbit around Mercury, Phoebus will be able to send back much more detailed analysis of Mercury's exosphere, composition, and dynamics, including how it changes with location and time. Speaking of MESSENGER, back in its day, it discovered ice on Mercury's North Pole. BepiColombo will continue this legacy by continuing the search for ice in permanently shadowed regions of high-latitude craters. As you might know, Mercury is the only planet in our solar system to have a magnetic field similar to Earth's. Thanks to its liquid iron core, Mercury exhibits a dynamo effect, which creates an innate magnetic field around the planet. However, Mercury's magnetic field is just 1.1% that of Earth's magnetic field, leaving scientists fascinated with how it's generated. One of the big goals of the BepiColombo mission is understanding this magnetic field better. So far, the only magnetic activity of the Northern Hemisphere has been mapped by NASA's Messenger mission. Scientists hope that BepiColombo will be able to shed light on the dynamics of the planet's magnetism in the Southern Hemisphere. This magnetic field is of great importance. By understanding it, scientists aim to shed light on Mercury's origins, its evolutionary journey, and the current state of the planet's interior. MPO and MEO will travel through different areas of Mercury's magnetosphere on different timescales, simultaneously measuring how the magnetic field changes over time and space, and its relationship to the powerful solar wind. All this new data from the BepiColombo mission will eventually be compared with global magnetic field models from the Messenger mission to build the most accurate picture yet of Mercury's magnetic field, which could unlock telling insights into the planet's elusive past. As we await BepiColombo's next flyby in September 2024, the journey to understanding Mercury continues. The spacecraft is gearing up for its next major maneuver, a prolonged solar electric propulsion thruster arc planned to begin in early August, and it should last until mid-September. Thruster arcs, along with strategic flybys, help BepiColombo brake against the enormous gravitational pull of the Sun. This is the only way to successfully insert into orbit around Mercury when the time comes. Once in orbit in December 2025, the real exploration begins. Mercury's heavily cratered surface records a 4.6 billion year history of asteroid and comet bombardment, which together with unique tectonic and volcanic curiosities will help scientists unlock the secrets of the planet's place in solar system evolution. BepiColombo is set to remain in orbit around Mercury for 1 year, and if all goes well, might get the green light for an extra year on the mission. Scientists hope to study the planet like never before, from its composition to its geophysics, its atmosphere and magnetosphere, both its history and the history of other inner planets like it, including Earth. Until then, we've got a few more flybys to look forward to, and the haunting pictures they're bound to capture for us Earthlings back home. The universe is full of beauty, but when we're in a bad headspace, it can be pretty hard to see it sometimes. When your mental health is not the healthiest, it can be exhausting. Your brain runs in circles, diminishing your ability to function in your day-to-day. You're stressed, and you're stressed about being stressed. But it feels terrifying to open up about how you're feeling, because you worry others will think poorly of you, or they just won't understand. But that's where therapists can be so vital, because having someone experienced, who won't sit there judging you, can make all the difference. BetterHelp, the paid partner for today's video, is an online platform that connects you up to therapists around the country. It's all online, including the sessions themselves, making it much easier for you to schedule appointments and to find someone who really can hear you out. Opening up about what's going on can be a massive relief. If you think that BetterHelp might be able to help you, why not go to betterhelp.com/Astrum? Doing so, or choosing Astrum during signup, will give you a special discount off your first month of therapy. Since the last video, I was honestly blown away by all the incredibly kind comments and messages you've sent me, and by the numbers of you that signed up to the Patreon. Like I said in the replies to your DMs on Patreon, everyone here at the Astrum team is so grateful to have such an amazing community. If you haven't joined the Patreon party yet, we're still on our long-term 1,000 patron member drive, so you can go to the link in the pinned comment to become a part of that effort.